We'll play it live, and then we'll just say hi to everybody. Mauricio, where are you out of today?
I am in West Hollywood right now, and just outside of Beverly Hills.
Nice. Nice, man.
Yeah.
Not too far. Jason, how about you, bud?
I'm in Boca Raton, Florida today.
Oh, wow. Wait, where do you usually
Back and
stay?
forth between here and New York City. Depends what day you catch me on.
Nice, nice.
Yeah.
I like that. Eric, how about you, buddy? Where are you at?
I'm in Denver today.
Denver.
Back home today.
And Stu, how about you?
I am home at the Jersey Shore, so living the dream.
Oh, shit. Let's go.
Nice
That's
stuff.
it.
You going to the Stone Pony?
I am literally 2 miles from the Stone Pony, for those of you who know. It's
The
it's
best.
awesome. It's awesome.
The
I love it.
best.
I could almost walk there. So, yeah.
I like that. I like that. All right. And obviously, I'm out here in Thousand Oaks, California, close to Malibu. Let's get going. We've got Eric Saxon, Breakthrough Broker. Stu Jacobson, you probably know him from teaching you all about real estate, getting your real estate license. A very familiar face. Mauricio Umansky, who you also know, and Jason Haber. He and Mauricio are our guests today. They're the ones who started this American Real Estate Association. That's why we're here. We want to see the option of doing things a little bit differently. And so, Jason, we'll go to you first and tell us a little bit about what is this and why do we need it?
Yeah, well, first of all, thank you for having us. We appreciate the forum and opportunity to speak to everyone. I know there'll be lots of questions, and we'll do our best to answer them. I came about this almost by accident, truly by accident, when in the fall, stories of sexual harassment and assault came out of the New York Times on August 26th, and I was disappointed at the reaction of the real estate industry. To be clear, no real estate boards, no large firms, no one was calling for change in the industry. And I thought that was wrong. So I started the NAR Accountability Project. We put together a 4-point plan, a nationwide coalition. We made lots of changes in the, we pushed for lots of changes and got lots of changes, is the long and short of it. I was very proud of the work that we did and what we accomplished at the NAR Accountability Project. So as this is happening and as we're working on this fall, the lawsuits, the first trial gets underway. The messaging from NAR was, we got this, we're going to win, we're going to win. And then, shorter than a flight from Palm Beach to LaGuardia Airport in New York, the verdict came back and they lost. And you had these twin crises. And yes, the lawsuits had nothing to do with the sexual harassment issue. But I actually see them as inextricably linked because I think that they show flaws in the organization. And as an industry, I felt that we could do better. And at the time, I was not thinking about starting a trade association. To be honest, we were working on reforming NAR. And then I heard my man speak. Now, Mauricio was the first person to stand up and say, maybe we should do something else. Maybe we should do our own thing. And that actually got me thinking. And I was like, maybe he's right. So that began our conversation and dialogue to thinking, you know, other industries have multiple trade associations, national trade associations. It's kind of weird that lawyers, 15% of lawyers are members of the American Bar Association, 17% of doctors are members of the American Medical Association, but 99% of all agents are members of the National Association of Realtors. The more we looked at the statistics, the more we looked at the organization, we thought there was an opportunity in this sort of upheaval to add a new voice. And that's why we came together and started the American Real Estate Association.
That makes sense. Mauricio, quick question. How does this intertwine with PLS? Does it, or what does this look like?
Yeah, great question. It does and it does not intertwine with PLS. Okay. The PLS was something that, you know, we started as a database in order to hold off-market listings. And, you know, we all know that, you know, quickly after that, NAR passed the rule called the Clear Cooperation Policy that basically stopped everybody from, you know, advertising and having, you know, off-market listings. But, you know, from my perspective, that was kind of, you know, the genesis or part of the idea of what's happening right now in terms of the monopolistic society and the stronghold that NAR has had over the industry. And one of the reasons why we're in these big, huge lawsuits, again, I'm not going to get into super opinions of that, but obviously, you know, not having the open ability to have open competition, free markets, everything that the United States is all about, is kind of the issue and the reason why we are having so many issues in the beginning of, you know, the falling apart of, you know, the associations and the openness and the creation of the ability to have new associations. I believe the free competition causes, you know, better results. It creates innovation. It creates better pricing. It creates all of these things that is, you know, what all of this is about. You know, my perspective is that so they are somewhat intertwined because of the PLS and because of my antitrust lawsuit that I had against NAR. I got an inside look on NAR. I got an inside look similarly to the way that Jason got an inside look into what was happening from his perspective with the accountability project and what he was attacking. I got an inside look because I was, you know, in the middle of a lawsuit against them. And I got a chance to read, discover, really understand, and I got really, you know, thrown into this thing. And when all of this thing started to happen, there were multiple people that started to call me and say, Mauricio, you're kind of like the voice, and, you know, you're somebody that can start something. You've got, you know, the ability and the know-how and the notoriety to help, you know, get something started. And because of my love to the industry, the real estate industry has given so much to me, and I want to give so much back to it, is kind of the reason I took this on. And I took on, you know, the because this is a thankless job, guys. There's nothing, I mean, Jason is so, you know, there's no money in this thing. There's no this is strictly for the love of our business, and to create and be something that we can do something better. And that's, you know, I met Jason. We both had that passion. We both had that love. We approach it from different angles, you know, politically, differently, you know, all of the, everything, you know, which is what's important in order to create, you know, something, you know, to have, you know, something that's bipartisan politically when you're advocating and lobbying, and to have a voice. And really, this is just something that I just wanted to do to, you know, make the industry better. But because of the PLS, I got that inside look.
Got it. So that's the connection. Eric?
I've been so excited for this since we got it set up, because I have very similar views. I've been fairly outspoken over Breakthrough Brokers, been fairly outspoken over the course of the last 13 years. We owned a brokerage. I'm with you. Let's shift a little bit. We have a lot of realtors on here. We have access to a lot of agents who are going to see this. What would be your, what's your pitch? What's a reason a realtor would become part of this association? I'm interested to hear.
So not only do we not have the legacy issues which are surrounding the National Association of Realtors, we're going to offer a different perspective. And this is actually, I'll give Mauricio credit on this, because this is what he first came to me with. Less agents. Can you imagine that? A trade association advocating for less agents, better agents, elevated agents. Now, in 1978, the average agent did 12 deals a year before email, social media, cell phones, you name it. 1978, they did 12 deals a year. 2022, the last time the data is available, do you know how many deals the average agent did? 7.8. Why? All the efficiencies, all the technology we have today, agents do less deals today than they did in the 70s. The answer is there's so many more of them. Because it's so easy to get licensed, and we're on this treadmill now of just adding everyone's nephews, brothers, cousins, sisters, an agent. Who benefits from that? I'll tell you this, it's not the agents that benefit from that. Now, if you're a trade association, this mandatory requirement for annual dues, sure, you benefit from more agents. But we think that the industry has suffered from that, and the consumer has suffered from that. 49% of those agents don't even do more than one deal a year. And so we think there's a better way. And we think if we elevate the industry, if you're interested in elevating the industry, then we think we're the trade association for you. We may not be for everyone. We don't want to be for everyone. But if you think there's a better way to elevate the industry, higher standards, higher requirements, more education, more training, more discipline, more professionalism, then we think we're the trade association for you. And that's a message you're not going to hear from others out there.
It's not only about less agents. I want to be clear. Less agents will occur because we want to raise the barrier to entry. Right. We want to elevate the education that is required to be a real estate agent. We want to make it more difficult to, you know, fund the continued education. We want to do all of that stuff. This is not about less. We're not on a mission to create, you know, less jobs. We're on a mission to elevate the agent.
I love that. Go ahead.
No, I kind of wanted to jump into that because, you know, as someone who works with thousands of agents across the country to help them get licensed, you know, saying that you want to raise that barrier of entry, I love that. I think that that's a great message. But what my question to you right now would be is this, you know, because like I said, the people in my audience are new agents coming into the industry, and there's a lot of noise. There's a lot of noise going on. There's a lot of animosity. I think there's a lot of tension from people who are seeing what's going on with NAR, and there's a lot of emotions going on. So what I want to ask you is this. I think there's a lot of good things that NAR does. What I'd like for you to tell me is something that you feel that NAR does well, you know, and how would you emulate that in, you know, the new association? And also, you know, you've kind of pointed out like areas that you think are going to be like negatives that you want to, like I said, improve on, like the barrier to entry and elevating the professionalism. But I really want to know something that you think NAR does well right now.
Yeah.
And the second question that I would have for you is, what would be your messaging specifically for new agents coming into the industry? Mm-hmm. Because we are going to have new agents. And I think that they need a simplified message as to what they should expect coming into the industry. So that's my question for both of you.
So great question. So NAR is the biggest political contributor in this country. They have a strong presence in Washington, D.C., and they do a good job at the federal level. And we have already been working on federal issues. We are very, very, very new. We're brand new, but that doesn't mean we can't punch above our fighting weight. Right now, our trade association is very active in Washington, working on the VA loan guarantee program, which, as you guys probably know, is at a moment of crisis right now because of the settlement terms. Let me be clear, no laws have changed. People are talking about these changing laws. To be clear, this is a business practice change and a settlement. No laws have changed. And because no laws have changed, the laws are no longer congruent with the proposed change of business practice. And veterans in this country, starting on August 17th, are facing a very, very dire situation where they will be disenfranchised from the market in some cases. They'll not be able to use the loan guarantee program if they have an agent and they have to compensate that agent. And we're looking at really doing a disservice to our country, to our veterans, which I think is outrageous. I know Mauricio agrees with me. And so we dove right in. We've already spoken with the House Subcommittee on Housing and Education. We're speaking with the Financial Services Committee. We're speaking with policymakers, legislators in Washington. And it's complicated to fix. It requires both statutory reform and regulatory reform, but it can be done, and it needs to be done ASAP before we disenfranchise veteran buyers in this country. So that's just to answer your question. That's just one example of where we think NAR does well at the federal level. They obviously have a huge PAC. I didn't know they were the biggest political contributor in America in terms of PAC sizes. Most people are surprised to hear that.
And Jason, I just want to say this. One maybe a recommendation, but also maybe an ask of you. You know, I think that is one of the biggest strengths of NAR, but I think that they do one of the poorest jobs of communicating that, because you just said you didn't know that they were one of the biggest PACs. And then you're sitting there and then we're saying, hey, that's one of the things that we have to carry over into a new association. So like, how are you going to educate members? Because I'm sure that there are also members here. One of the reasons why there is animosity is because people don't know what NAR does. And that's why I wanted to ask you that question, because I think that there's the emotion, the charged emotions come from. And hey, if you're in the chat right now, tell me what you think on that, you know, because I think that a lot of people don't realize that. I'll give it back to you.
I think NAR, I want to jump in on this thing. I think NAR does a lot of great things. Okay. They're huge. They have, and I want to be super clear. You guys have heard me say this 100 times, competition makes people better. Okay. And if what we can do as the American Real Estate Associations, as real estate agents in the industry that care about make NAR better when it's already a behemoth and huge and et cetera, et cetera. And we can make them communicate better. We can make them do better things, et cetera, et cetera. I'm all in. Their code of ethics, beautiful code of ethics, whether they follow them or not, from the perspective of, you know, of the issues that, you know, Jason was talking about earlier, the sexual harassment starting at the top and all the cover-ups and all of that stuff, that's a different story. But the code of ethics that's out there for the real estate agents and the way that we are, you know, supposed to take care of our clients through a fiduciary duty, through a proper duty, love it, okay? Their advocacy work in the federal government, love it. Their advocacy and lobbying work at the regional level, terrible. Their communication, terrible. These are the types of things that, you know, if we can do better, we can make them better. We all win. Like, I want to be clear. This is not about destroying anybody. This is not about taking anybody down. This is about making an industry that that has given so much to me better. And that's what this is all about. And through competition, you make things better. Okay. By raising the bar, you make things better. And that's really what my mission is making this industry better, making NAR better, making them communicate better. All of those things is what I care about.
I think it also boils down to helping the agent on the street. I think NAR lost track of that at some point and was hoping the local organizations were going to take care of that. But I see the local organizations looking up to NAR for help. I'll also say,
Eric, they don't take care of us. That's the biggest problem. They don't take care of us. It's an association for real estate agents. It's the National Association of Realtors. Realtors are us. Okay. We pay a fee to be a realtor, whether we are a realtor or a real estate advisor or whatever we want to call ourselves, et cetera, et cetera. They're not there for us. They're there for themselves. They're protecting their profits. They've got a for-profit arm. They've got all of these different things. All of these rules that they pass are so much for protecting themselves. They sit there and they talk and they get on stage and they talk about how the settlement agreement protects everybody and every real estate broker, except for real estate brokerages that do above $2 billion. Okay. The real estate brokerages that do above $2 billion probably employ the vast majority of the real estate agents in the industry. Okay. They also control the vast majority of the transactions in the industry. Okay. But they sit there and they get on stage and they say, sorry. Sorry is not good enough. Okay. Because the reality is they could have protected us, and they could have protected us by putting more money up for the settlement agreement. Okay. Not by putting up $418 million. Yeah. Sorry. I was only willing to put up $400 million. But you know what? They have a surplus of north of $100 million per year. That's their surplus. Yeah. Okay. Their settlement talks about a 4-year payout. That's $400 million. All they're doing is operating at a zero surplus for 4 years. What are they could have thrown in more money and protected everybody if they cared about the realtors, because the realtors are the ones that take it. And then they get up on stage and they just say, sorry, I was there. I was present. Okay. Kevin Spears got up on stage and he says to everybody that's in this room that does above $2 billion, all I can say to you is, sorry, we wanted to help you, but they didn't let us. It's not that they didn't let us. We didn't throw enough money at it. That's the reality. And we wanted to make sure that the National Association of Realtors was looking out for themselves, because all they've been talking to us is they've been talking to us about, don't worry about this lawsuit. We're going to appeal it. We're going to do that. The reason we didn't do that and he got up on stage and said it is because they would have gone bankrupt. Okay. And the reason they created the settlement at $400 million and not more is because they would have gone bankrupt. So it's all finances. It's not about the realtors.
Not the real.
It's a Faustian bargain.
I agree. I there's some questions that I think are interesting in the chat that I'm going to ask Tristan, if you don't mind. One of them, Arnold asks, at NAR, we're realtors. In your organization, what are we? And he says, it does matter. So how do you answer that? So
the word is trademark. So the word is trademark protected. They got the mark in 1950, actually. So no, we don't have a word. You're a real estate professional with us, but we don't own the word, the mark, and we don't have a trademark for the R, but you're a real estate professional who's a member of our association.
Got it.
How do you address certain areas where NAR owns the MLS and you have access through that? Now, I do know most associations have to give non-NAR members access. But if on a grand scale, let's say we start seeing an exodus and you start picking up steam and we're coming over to you, how are you going to address some of those? You know, it's going to cost me more money to join my MLS because now I'm a member of your trade association. How are you guys looking at that from a logistics point of view?
So there, you're right about this trend. And just, I think a few days ago, RealTrax in Tennessee announced, not for the first time, that non-NAR members can join the MLS. And I think that's going to be the trend of 2025. You're going to see, has to be. So you're going to see that. That's going to cure a lot of the complexity that you're talking about. The other issue, you have 800 plus MLSs in the country right now. I know people who are members of 6 or 7 MLS. I don't know what the record is. I want to see if anyone here is a member of more than 6. That's like the most I've seen. But you're talking about 6 times paying fees for access. We think this is a dated way to do business. And it also stifles innovation. You know, if you're trying to create a product with an API that goes into an MLS and you have 800 different systems to integrate with, is it any wonder that so many MLSs
back in
1998, right?
I live that every day at my company, so I'm with you.
So you know exactly what I'm talking about. So we have been self-stifling our own industry and stopping innovation. It's got to change. And so we're part of that conversation, right? So how we help as we go, we'll see, as we start talking to MLSs, this is all part of the evolving landscape of the industry.
Do you see?
I think there has to be one MLS. I think that's my opinion personally, and I think that'll happen as we open up the borders for when I say borders, we open up the borders for free competition and get rid of this monopolistic idea that we have to do so many things. It'll reduce pricing. It'll let the real estate agents take back control of their data, have choices. It'll give us the ability, the access to be able to work in multiple areas. There's a lot of technology that can become a lot better through MLSs that have been held back because they have been protected by the National Association of Realtors and have not had competition. And again, competition creates better. There's just a lot of different things that we need that can be done in order to improve that kind of stuff.
Mauricio, here's why you say that. Because you're a real estate agent. I'm a real estate agent. Everyone that's an actual real estate agent practicing agrees with, we need one MLS.
Yeah.
Which is so crazy that we don't have one already at this point. And it's baffling.
And if you think about it, you're licensed by your state, not by your local county, certainly not by an MLS or real estate board, but yet you're constricted in how you can do business based on what MLS you happen to be in. So in New York State, I can only transact in the 5 boroughs of New York City. Once I got to Long Island, where I'm from, I have to join the MLS out there, or the Hamptons. I have to join. Like, why? I'm licensed by the state of New York. I should be able to freely transact in the state. It's a restraint of trade on every single agent in this country. Yeah. And it's time that we reform that.
Absolutely. Very true. I think we're all in agreement on that. Quick, another question. Sorry, Tristan, I'm not trying to monopolize the question. I do notice as I'm out and Tristan speaking all over the country and me too, I do realize a little heavier allegiance to the local boards of realtors because they have local relationships. In your roadmap for this new trade association, are you looking at creating similar local organizations to have a tighter network from what you're doing at the national level? Is that in your roadmap at all?
It actually is. We'll go on, Mauricio.
So Jason and I are going to say the same thing. To be clear, we are, you know, we're advocating for, you know, if you want to be a member of two associations, you don't have to choose one or the other. We are already in conversations with a bunch of local real estate associations that we've been talking to about allowing us to be part of their association and not needing to change the local regional associations. There's already a great web of people and communications in the country. We don't need to go and re-change everything. It's low-hanging fruit. Let's just make things better, okay? Today, There's a bunch of stuff that's happened around the world, you know, and again, we're not using technology. AI right now is amazing. Okay. Like, let's use AI to really understand every single regional issue that's happening in the real estate world. And let's make sure that we're advocating for that kind of stuff. Okay. There was not Los Angeles, ULA, the mansion tax. It's been an absolute disaster. Yeah. There was not enough advocacy from national associations or realtors or from California associations of realtors, okay, to make sure that all of us real estate agents knew what was going on. I mean, I would talk to real estate agents and I would tell them what was going on. They were baffled. They didn't understand it. They didn't even know about it. Now, if we as an American real estate association go to California associations, we make the effort, we put it out there, we advocate, we let everybody know, and nobody does anything, then guess what, guys? You as real estate agents have no right to complain.
Yeah,
if you do some, it's on us to make sure we know about it. It's on us to do something about it. If nobody listens, if nobody, don't complain. Okay. But not doing anything is what the problem is. And the reality is that right now we're just not doing enough of that. So we want to work with the local associations if they want to work with us. We don't need to break that up at all. That is not our intent.
Awesome.
Quick question. You know, cause I think that there's a lot of excitement and I see a lot of people commenting in the chat that, you know, they're in agreement with a lot of the things that we're saying. They're in agreement with a lot of the sentiment that we have. So I think that my question for both you gentlemen is, what is a fair time frame as far as when people could start taking action and start saying, and also too, let me just add another thing in there. How can they help support you? You know, that's probably, you know, like an end of webinar kind of question. But I mean, I wanted to answer that because I think that, like I said, there's a lot of emotional sentiment that we're kind of getting here. We're all in agreement. And I think there's a lot of sentiment that the audience is getting, that they're in agreement with what you're saying and the cheerleading that you're saying. But what is this time frame look like? What does the roadmap look like? And what if there is someone in this audience right now that is like, we want to help support what you were doing? How is that? How does that look?
Well, amazing. Well, we have an advisory board already with some amazing agents. We have working group. We have five working groups that report back to the advisory committee. If folks want to help, we'd love to have the support. We're top of the first inning here. So everything is really new and fresh. I think the amazing Danielle Garofalo, who's in the chat, I believe. Danielle, she posted the link earlier. You can sign up there. You can DM me on social at Jason Haber on Instagram or Twitter, X, whatever. Get in touch. We'll be happy to plug you in. This is ground floor stuff. Like, we're building something here, but we're building something durable that's long lasting, which means we're not rushing. We're gonna do it the right way. So we're laying a good foundation now and putting that team together. So if there are people who'd like to help, we could use the help, and we'd love to have more voices. We'd love to have as much diverse voices as possible as we grow the trade association. And then the second part of your question.
The second part of my question, I was asking, how could they basically? It was basically how could they get involved, and I was asking about your timeframes and how they get involved. So that was the one thing that I think that we're missing, because I know that we're really early on. Just kind of like a time frame on this. Like, what is your like, if you had to put a rough roadmap together as far as like when people could start seeing things kind of come to fruition, and also where's it starting? I assume that with the East Coast and New York, but. Yeah.
I'm going to jump on that. We're starting bi-coastal. Jason's based in in New York. I'm based in California. We're starting bi-coastal. We have officially formed the association. It's official. We just got it formed. We just got our designations. So that's now finally going. We got the trademarks. I think we got them passed already. We might be expecting them tomorrow or the next day, whatever, any day now. We are starting an outreach. I think what people can do is, if you care and you want to have a voice, sign up at the American Real Estate Association. The link's in the chat. Start participating, start paying attention. Start talking to your broker about it and tell them that you're interested. What we're going to be doing is we're going to start an outreach program to brokers in about 3 weeks. 2 to 3 weeks. We're going to start going to the brokers and we're going to start giving them an opportunity to join, tell them what we're doing. And getting involved. So you know, from your guys' perspective as real estate agents, talk to your managers, talk to your brokers, talk to your owners, like, you know, because we will start an outreach program. Help us start an outreach program within your own brokerage firm if you're interested, okay? And let's start getting involved. So the timing is now, Stu. Yeah, go ahead.
One question that came in that I really kind of want to jump on, then I'm going to kick it back to Tristan and Eric. Some members have said, hey, we want to join, we want to sign up, and we want to, as I said, get involved because they're definitely souped up about this. The question is, can I be a member of NAR as well as a member of AREA, you know, and is this something that, will there be any potential conflicts there? What is it that they should know about as far as being a member, being both a realtor and being a part of your trade organization?
We're good with you being a member of both. In the medical world, there are people are a member of multiples. In the legal world, people are a member of multiple associations. There's no reason why, you know, you shouldn't be a member of two if you want to, or one, or none. Our perspective is you should have a choice. That's the bottom line. It's a free world, and we should have a choice.
And I did notice in the questions that, yeah, we are a nonprofit. We only want to answer to our members, which are agents. We don't want to have shareholders to answer to. That could be an inherent conflict. So we're dedicated fully to the real estate agents of this country.
I get a quick question for you, Mauricio. With you starting the agency and continuing it to grow and being involved in it, what have you learned there that you're going to apply to this association and saying, hey, look, we've done so well here with agents. People love this, that we're going to bring this over here.
Yeah, it's a great question. I think that they're completely different. You know, obviously we are in the brokerage business and we do business, and that's what, you know, and I'm still a real estate agent today. I still sell a lot. I think that, you know, what we can learn from this is I go back to the beginning of the conversation, this free competition, and competition makes people better. Okay. I mean, I can tell you that when we started, you know, 6 months, Compass and I started 6 months apart. Okay. And there is no question that Compass has made the agency better. And there is no question that the agency has made Compass better. And there's no question that the two of us have made the brokerage firms that have been in the business forever, just like NAR has, better. Okay. So all of this competition has made things better. Okay. And that's what I hope to do. What did I learn? I learned that in order to satisfy people, in order to keep your agents happy, you have to be willing to innovate. You have to be willing to listen to people. You have to be willing to care. You have to be transparent. You have to be vulnerable. You have to be real. Okay. Those are the types of characteristics that we want to bring to the American Real Estate Association. That's what I've learned.
That's a good answer, man. I like it. That was good. Nice. Eric, anything in closing, man?
No, I mean, obviously, Jason, Mauricio, Breakthrough Brokers, interested in helping out however we can, making the industry better. It's been part of what it's our mission for 13 years. So whatever help you need, further offline conversations, it'll be fun to talk.
We will reach
out.
Thank you.
Yeah, guys, we're here to help out. So we love you guys. You support us. We support you.
Thank you, guys. Thank you for everything. And great conversation today.
Yeah, I really appreciate everyone's time. And if you have any other questions, please feel free to reach us offline. We'd love to connect further and address any questions. And hope you consider joining us, too. We'd love to have you.
Thanks, guys. We appreciate your time. Tristan, we'll talk later, buddy. Thanks guys. Everybody.